Well, good morning, church. I just want to wish you a warm welcome this morning if you're in the house or joining us online. I just want to welcome you. Just a reminder that today we will be having communion. So for those of you at home, you are welcome to just make sure you have your elements ready for when we get to that part of the service. Let us pray before we go into worship this morning. Father, we just thank you that we can gather this morning and just come and reflect on what Jesus did for us. And I pray that as we worship you this morning, that you will just come and remind us, God, of what you've done. As we ponder on this and reflect on the cross this morning, God, we're just so thankful and so grateful for the sacrifice, your sacrifice, so that we could have life everlasting. And I pray that we will never take it for granted. We just worship you this morning, and every note we sing, Father, be a sweet sound to you and bring glory to you this morning. We pray this in your name. Amen.
See you.
Light of the world, treasure of heaven, brilliant like the stars in the wintry sky. Joy of the Father, reach through the darkness, shine across the earth, send the shadows to fly. Light of the world, from the beginning, the tragedies of time were no match for your love. From great heights of glory, you saw my story. God, you entered.
Come and adore.
Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the
Well, good morning, everyone. A very, very welcome, warm welcome to all of you. Thank you so much, Lene and the team, for leading us in worship this morning. Great to see JJ back in action. Welcome. Lovely to see you this morning. It's great. Every Sunday or every time we come together, I see some more old familiar faces. So it's really great to see you guys. Welcome to those of you joining us online this morning for our Good Friday service. A very special welcome to you. Thank you for joining us. Just a reminder again to add to Lene's, if you are at home, we are having communion today, so you might want to get the communion elements ready so long. So friends, it's Good Friday today, and as you can see from the image up on the screen, our Easter theme this year is in the garden, in the garden. See, gardens come up again and again throughout the scriptures. One of the first things we read about in the Bible immediately after the creation account is a garden. Genesis chapter 2 verse 8 says, "Now the Lord God had planted a garden in the east, in Eden, and there he put the man he had formed. The Lord God made all kinds of trees grow out of the ground, trees that were pleasing to the eye and good for food." And so this garden, this first garden that we encounter in the Bible, was a perfect place as God intended it to be. It was a place of beauty, of functionality. There was food there. It was a place of completeness and peace because God's presence was there. And there in the garden, God met in person with Adam and Eve and walked with them in the cool of the evening. And there was direct community. There was intimacy and fellowship and relationship with God in that garden. That first garden is a picture of God's perfection and his provision. But it is also the place where rebellion against God happened. Of all the abundant provision available to Adam and Eve, they chose to disobey God and to eat the fruit of the one tree in the garden that God forbade them to eat from. And with that, the fall happened. Sin entered into the world and man was alienated from God. And so we see that the Bible starts with a garden, but it also ends with a garden. The book of Revelation gives us a picture of heaven. And in chapter 22, it talks about the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal. And it tells us that on each side of this river stands the tree of life, yielding fruit perpetually, its leaves providing healing for the nations. This is the very same tree of life referred to in the book of Genesis, which Adam and Eve failed to eat from. This tree, which was to provide eternal life for Adam and Eve and all their descendants, is in that lost garden. So there in Revelation, we see there is a river, there is a tree or trees, there is fruit. This is a garden. It is the new restored Eden. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 7, it is referred to as the paradise of God. And so we speak about paradise. You may recall as Jesus hung on the cross that Friday, 2,030 odd years ago, with two robbers on either side of him, he turned to the one and he said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." The Greek word translated as paradise literally means garden or park. And so the Bible is bookended by gardens. In the front of the Bible, we have the Garden of Eden, which was a garden of rebellion, where man disobeyed God and sin entered into the equation. And at the back of the Bible, we have the Garden of Paradise, or heaven, which is a garden of rejoicing. It paints the picture of perfection, where there is no more death, no more weeping. It is a place of restoration and peace and purity, and it is where the whole of history is heading. That garden is the believer's unique destination that has been made possible through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. So we have a garden in the beginning and we have a garden at the end. But in the middle of God's great narrative, we find two other highly significant gardens. We have the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus was betrayed with a kiss. His last hours before his arrest were spent there in that garden, and we'll be looking at that today. It was the place where the awful implication and the full weight of what was about to happen as Jesus took on the sin of all humanity came crashing in. The Garden of Gethsemane was a place of anguish and sorrow and turmoil. It was where Jesus was betrayed and deserted by his disciples. It was also the place where he came to terms with the rejection that would come from the Father. Gethsemane was a garden of rejection. But there was also another garden, a garden with a tomb in it, a garden where the stone was rolled away and our Savior rose from the dead. That is the Garden of Redemption, and we'll visit that garden on Sunday. So, four gardens in the Bible. Let's turn our attention now to the Garden of Gethsemane, the Garden of Rejection. If you had a Passover meal in your home last night, you would have reenacted to some extent the last meal that Jesus and his disciples had that Thursday evening. And after the meal, Jesus and his disciples left the upper room where they had gathered. And they would have walked through the dark city streets of Jerusalem. And they would have passed through one of Jerusalem's gates, crossed over the Kidron Valley, which ran along the east side of the city, and made their way to the Garden of Gethsemane, which was at the base of the Mount of Olives. Here's an aerial view of what Jerusalem looked like in Jesus' time. And that red arrow there you can see on the right-hand side of the screen, that's the Mount of Olives. Where the yellow arrow is, somewhere along there was the Garden of Gethsemane. Nobody knows for sure where it was. You can see the Kidron Valley there, and on the other mount, on the other side, is the city of Jerusalem. And that red square that you see there, that is the Temple Mount. So it was imposing, and from the Garden of Gethsemane, it would have towered over them from the other side of the Kidron Valley. Now, the word Gethsemane means oil press. So this garden most likely contained an oil press where olives, which were grown on the Mount of Olives, were crushed, and their oil extracted for cooking and lighting purposes. And the book of John tells us in John chapter 18, verse 2, that Jesus and his disciples had often gone there. It was one of their hangouts. Now, let's pick up the story in Matthew chapter 26, from verse 36 through to verse 44. And we're not going to read it all through in one go, but I'll break it up and comment as we go through the passage. So if you have a Bible or a device and you'd like to follow, or you can just follow on the screens, reading from Matthew chapter 26, verse 36. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, that would be James and John, along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Friends, it's an interesting choice of words that Jesus uses here. He says, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death." Now, I don't think he was exaggerating for effect. In fact, Jesus' anguish was so intense that in Luke's gospel, in Luke chapter 22, verse 43 and 44, we're told that an angel from heaven appeared to him, to Jesus, and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. Jesus' sorrow at that point in time was so great that he was quite literally at the point of death. And apart from the supernatural intervention of that angel, he would not have died on the cross. He would have died there in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus was given this supernatural strength by the angel so that he could stand up and endure the physical and emotional demands of his coming arrest and his trial and his ultimate, his crucifixion. You see, Jesus' suffering was not merely him in his humanity struggling with the ugly realities of the cross. His was a supernatural suffering. It was the unique, unparalleled suffering of the sinless God-man who alone could fathom the depths of God's righteousness and the extent of man's sin and the frightful measure of divine wrath that God's righteousness required. Friends, even with the benefit of hindsight, 2,000 years of Christianity and millions of books and commentaries and sermons and hundreds of Bible translations, we cannot fully comprehend the depths of God's righteousness, nor the full implications of man's sinful rebellion against God. And we definitely have no more than a vague inkling of God's displeasure at sin, the awful measure of his wrath, and the tremendous cost involved in removing our sin. We are quite literally blissfully ignorant of these things. If we but fully knew the extent of the holiness and the righteousness of God, and we were able to juxtapose that with the seriousness of our sin, and we were able to put our sin into context in view of God's holiness and righteousness, our souls would be so perplexed that we would quite literally lose our minds. Our hearts would break from the anguish, and we would die. Jesus, being God in human form, did know these things. He fully understood and comprehended the seriousness of the situation, and so he was supernaturally strengthened because he supernaturally suffered. There is debate as to whether Jesus literally sweated blood. And there is a medical condition called hematidrosis, where under extreme mental anxiety and emotional distress, the capillary blood vessels that supply the sweat glands literally rupture, causing blood to be secreted with sweat. So it is more likely than not that Jesus literally did sweat blood. But whether he actually literally sweated blood or not doesn't change the extent of his stress and anguish. You know, the mere fact that he was sweating in what would have been a cold night already speaks about his state of anxiety and anguish in that moment. I think it's very significant that Jesus here comes before his disciples and he openly expresses the depth of his anguish and his sorrow. He does not avoid the harsh truth of his situation, nor does he stoically try to hide it. He knows what lies ahead. He who is without sin is going to take on the sins of the world as if they are his, and he is going to face the full wrath of the Father whom he loves. None of us have ever experienced, nor will we ever experience, the level of sorrow and anguish that Jesus felt that night. But what Jesus shows us is that it is okay to acknowledge what we are feeling. Expressing our feelings honestly in times of trouble is not a sign of weakness, but of humanity and humility. It shows a willingness to not be in control, and it's an invitation to others to let them love us and to minister to us and encourage us. Nonetheless, can you imagine how the disciples felt? It must have been quite disturbing for them to hear these words of Jesus. They had been with Jesus for 3 years, and they had seen him function in many different and difficult circumstances. It was Jesus who calmly confronted a terrifying demoniac and faced a frightening storm at sea. They'd seen him perform numerous miracles, and they'd heard his wise words of teaching. They'd seen his calm in the face of severe opposition from the religious authorities. And apart from that incident where Jesus drove the money changers out of the temple, he generally comes across in the Gospels as a man who is cool, calm, and collected. And now, here he stands, and he admits to being overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Here in this place where olives are crushed so that the oil can be used for light, Jesus, the light of the world's soul, is crushed to the point of death as he feels this incredible burden bearing down on him. Let's read on from verse 39 in Matthew 26. Going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went away a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them, and he went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Jesus had told the disciples that his soul was overwhelmed with sorrow. Now, here we see the depth of his anguish in the words he speaks to the Father, asking for the cup to be taken from him. So what is this cup? And why did it fill Jesus with such dread? Well, it's helpful to look at a few passages from the Old Testament to shed light on this. Psalm 75, verse 6 to 8. "There's no one from the east or the west or from the desert can exalt themselves. It is God who judges. He brings one down, he exalts another. In the hand of the Lord is a cup full of foaming wine mixed with spices. He pours it out, and all the wicked drink it down to its very dregs." Isaiah 51, verse 17. "Awake, awake, rise up, Jerusalem, you who have drunk the cup of his wrath, you who have drained to its dregs the goblet that makes people stagger." And the last one, Jeremiah 25, verse 15 and 16. "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, said to me," says Jeremiah. "Take from my hand this cup filled with the wine of my wrath, and make all the nations to whom I send you drink it. When they drink it, they will stagger and go mad because of the sword I will send among them." So friends, we see that this cup is God's wrath. See, Jesus wasn't afraid of dying. It wasn't death that worried him. He was God. And he knew that death couldn't hold him. In his humanity, he did feel pain, and he knew that his death would be a horrible, painful one, but it wasn't even the prospect of pain which caused his agony and his anguish. What Jesus was dreading was the wrath of God. The wrath of God aimed at sinful humanity being focused entirely on him. His agony was the prospect of being forsaken by God. In the Trinity, we have the perfect picture of community and love and togetherness and oneness and unity. And that was about to be broken when Jesus went to the cross. You see, on the cross, Jesus, who was the picture of sinless perfection, was going to be viewed and seen and considered by God the Father as the vilest, wickedest, most despicable person who had ever lived. He was to bear the sins of the world and face the full wrath of God for every sin ever committed by every human being who had ever lived and who would ever live in the future, including your sin and my sin. As I've already mentioned, with our limited and finite human minds, we cannot even begin to fully understand God's righteousness in relation to our sin. We as sinful people certainly cannot begin to fathom how it would feel to be at the receiving end of God's wrath for our own sins. Never mind being sinless and facing God's wrath for the sin of the entire human race, from creation to the consummation of the age. It's no wonder Jesus asked the Father to take the cup away. No wonder his anguish was to the point of death. The prospect of facing the full wrath of God for all the sins of all humanity weighed very, very heavily on our Lord that night. So why did Jesus ask, apart from the obvious reason, for the cup to be taken away? Was he having second thoughts in that moment? Was he getting cold feet? Was he trying to escape from his commitment to go to the cross? Was the fate of humankind hanging in the balance at that moment? You see, hypothetically, Jesus could have changed his mind. He could have chosen to not obey the Father, as did Adam and Eve in another garden. But it's very clear from all Jesus' actions seen as a whole that he was ready to obey the Father at all costs. Jesus knew what was coming. He could very easily have fled Jerusalem. There were other times in his ministry when he did just disappear, when he evaded the crowds and the authorities because his time had not yet come. But we see throughout Jesus' life a resolute intention on his part to do the will of the Father. And here, in the Garden of Gethsemane, nothing had changed. Jesus asks the Father, if there is another way, is there possibly another way for the sins of humanity to be forgiven? And he is ready to do the will of the Father and to do whatever is required of him, even if there had been another way. Whatever vehicle or method is needed to give effect to the Father's will, Jesus is ready to comply. But the bottom line is that there was no other way for humanity to be saved other than through the substitutionary sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. Jesus himself had said that he was the way and the truth and the life. There was no other way. No one could come to the Father except through him. Jesus knew that, and he was ready to do what needed to be done in order to make that happen, in order to give effect to the will of the Father. We're told that there was a large crowd or a great multitude that came that night in the Garden of Gethsemane to arrest Jesus, along with a detachment of soldiers. That's a few hundred soldiers. A detachment is a few hundred. And these soldiers were armed to the teeth. And they were there to take Jesus into captivity. And Peter takes out his sword, and he wants to defend Jesus. He was a fisherman, for goodness sake. What did he know about swordsmanship? And here he is willing to risk his life to protect Jesus, and yet in just a short while, he would vehemently deny knowing Jesus. And there's a whole sermon there, but maybe next year. But Jesus tells Peter in that moment, Jesus says to him that he could call on the Father, who would put at his disposal more than 12 legions of angels. In those days, a legion in the Roman army was 6,000 men. So Jesus technically could have called on 72,000 angels to help him at that point in time. Not that he needed to, because John tells us that when Jesus identified himself to this crowd, and he did so using God's name, he said, "I am," all these hundreds of armed soldiers fell to the ground. You see, the power of God in Jesus was so palpable at that moment that they all became weak in God's mighty and powerful presence. So Jesus didn't even need to call the angels. But we see that Jesus could very easily have escaped capture and evaded arrest. But humbly and meekly as a lamb, and in the words of Hebrews 12 verse 2, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame. Jesus said to the Father, not as I will, but as you will. And so we see that there was never any shadow of doubt that Jesus would willingly and voluntarily submit to the Father's will and go to the cross for us. Despite the level of his sorrow and anguish, despite the terrible price he would have to pay, Jesus was prepared to accept the cup the Father had prepared for him. Friends, Jesus was able to accept the Father's will, and he was ready to take the cup because he had an implicit trust in the Father, which flowed from a deep personal relationship with him. Friends, the question is, are we prepared to say to God, not as I will, but as you will? And are we prepared to go where God's will leads us? Are we ready to drink our cup, whatever it may be? As we run this race marked out for us, and as we submit to God's will for our lives, we may be required to face hardship and suffering. It's a mistake to think that being a Christian means that there will be no more hardship and pain. It's a mistake to presume that God exists for us and that he's there to serve us. The truth is that we exist for God and we are here to serve him. Being a follower of Christ comes at a cost. Jesus paid the ultimate price, but as we follow him, there is a cost involved and there is a price to pay. Because like Jesus, we need to be ready to say, not as I will, but as you will. Earlier this year, we looked at the spiritual disciplines. If you've been trying to do that, you'll know that putting these in place in our lives is costly and at times painful. More recently, we've been looking at the Beatitudes. Putting those in place in our lives is uncomfortable and painful and countercultural. They go against the grain. There is a cost involved in following Jesus. And the million-dollar question this Good Friday morning is, are you prepared to pay it? Whatever it may be, whatever the cost. Whatever price we need to pay, whatever pain and suffering we need to go through, Jesus is there with us. He is our strength when we are weak. And it's okay to feel sad and afraid and lonely because Jesus felt those things too. When we are in our own Gethsemane, praying for the cup to pass us by, we are not alone. Because unlike the disciples who fell asleep when Jesus needed them to keep watch with him, Jesus is there, awake and alert, and keeping watch with us, no matter what we're facing. The world and those critical of Christianity like to ask, where is God when there is suffering and pain? Where is God when a child gets cancer? Where is God when people are dying of starvation? Where is he when wars break out and atrocities are committed? Where is God when there are natural disasters that bring untold misery and suffering? Where is your God? The answer is he's right there in the midst of it. He was there in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he was there on the cross. He is no stranger to pain and to sorrow and to suffering. As we kneel in our Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus kneels beside us. He wraps an arm around us, and with the other one, he takes the cup from our hands. And with sweat dripping from his forehead, he says to us, I will drink this with you. I went to the cross for you, and it cost me everything. I'm not going to leave you on your own now. And so, friends, this morning, we end our story in this garden. The first garden, Eden, the Garden of Rebellion, led directly to the events that took place in this second garden. Gethsemane, the Garden of Rejection. The first Adam was disobedient in the first garden, and his disobedience led to death. Jesus Christ, the second Adam, was obedient to death in the second garden, even death on a cross. And his obedience leads to life. I'm going to call Lene and the team up. So long. Friends, we're going to end our service this morning by having communion together. And so I want to close my service this morning and ask you to prepare your hearts to receive communion by reading this passage from Isaiah chapter 53, verse 3 to 6. And I'm reading from the New Living Translation. He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with deepest grief. We turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised, and we did not care. Yet it was our weakness he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion. He was crushed for our sins. He was beaten so that we could be whole. He was whipped so that we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's paths to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. Won't you please stand and let's sing together, and you'll receive the elements for communion whilst we're singing.
Oh, so real.
be seated. What a beautiful song. Let's just reflect on those words again that we have just sung. The wonderful cross bids me come and die that I may truly live. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss and pour contempt on all my pride. Beautiful, beautiful words. Friends, communion is a visual and a tactile reminder of what happened in the Garden of Gethsemane that night. Having suffered this indescribable agony to the point of death, in the knowledge of God's disapproval that he would face for our sins, Jesus resolutely set his face on what was to come, and he submitted to the Father's will. He was arrested, beaten, flogged, and crucified. And on the cross, he died. And because he was the spotless Lamb of God, his sacrifice was perfect. It was made once and for all, and forever, forever removed the sin. Removed the need for any more sacrifices. Because through that one perfect sacrifice by Jesus on the cross, my sin and your sin and the sins of the world has been removed as far as the east is from the west. And so as we eat this bread together, which today is yeast-free matzo, symbolizes just the perfection of Jesus. As we eat this together, we are reminded that Jesus' body was given for us. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we can't begin to imagine what you went through that night. Lord, aside from the physical pain and the harsh reality of death, Lord, the prospect of facing the wrath of the Father, of being rejected by the Father, not for your sin, Lord, because you were sinless, but for our sin. Lord, we cannot comprehend. And so, Lord, with our feeble attempts, we want to give you thanks this morning for what you did for us. Thank you, Jesus, that you gave your body willingly and voluntarily. And thank you, Jesus, that you hung on the cross until it was finished and it was over and you did it. You paid the price for our sin. And as we eat this bread this morning, Lord, we do that with grateful hearts, just remembering again what you did for us and what that means for us as your children. And we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Let's eat together. The red juice that we drink is a reminder of Jesus' blood shed on the cross of Calvary. Jesus tells us that this cup, this is not God's cup of wrath, but it is the covenant. It is the cup of the covenant. It's the new covenant sealed in Jesus' blood. And we stand in a new covenant with God. The old is gone, the new has come. And we have a new restored relationship with our Father in heaven through Jesus Christ, precisely because he died on the cross for us, precisely because his blood flowed, and precisely because his blood cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Let us pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you for your blood that was shed on the cross of Calvary. Lord, we are so far removed from the sacrificial system that it's difficult for us to really understand why this happened. But Lord, we know that it had to happen. We know that it was God's plan. And Jesus, we know that you willingly and voluntarily went to the cross and shed your blood, the blood of the Son of God, the sinless one who died and bled for us, so that we may stand in a new covenant, in a new relationship with our Father in heaven. And we praise you for that this morning. And Jesus, as we drink this juice this morning, Lord, we just remember you. Remember what you did for us. And with grateful hearts, we say, thank you, Jesus. And we love you. Let's drink together. Friends, we're going to sing that song again. For the older people here, the Rigbys and so, you'll know that this is a hymn. Sorry, Pete. It's a beautiful hymn. It was written by Isaac Watts in 1707. And those words are just so true today still. So I'm not going to come up again. We're going to sing the song when it's finished. The service is over. We'll see you on Sunday morning. Be blessed and thank you so much for being here this morning. Won't you stand? Let's sing the song in closing.
Just get